thank my friend Stratis Kolibianakis for giving me such an easy task today. I mean, if we have an overview of the different causes and treatment of repeated implantation failure, you can see that there are no endocrine causes between them. Mrs. Chairperson, thank you very much for your kind attention. There is no endocrine causes at all for this. So, in any case, your endocrinologist can do something for you, so I've choose for the next 20 minutes to discuss about a rather well-established thing, that is the thyroid disease and its possible endocrine consequences, and another not so well-established, but believe me, emerging, that is vitamin D deficiency, hypovitaminosis D, in an attempt to prevent the available evidence, and as the majority of us are clinicians, I believe, in this room, to transfer this evidence into clinical practice. So let's kick off with thyroid disease. I'll try to briefly answer four questions. Do we have an evidence that the two axes, the thyroid one and the gonadal one, interplay? Do we have evidence for the basic science? And can we transfer it into clinical practice? Do we have evidence that there is interaction between thyroid disease or thyroid autoimmunity, already discussed today about autoimmunity and subfertility? Then I'm going to move on about what's happening exactly specifically in assisted reproduction technique, what's the involvement of thyroid axis, and finally going to treatment and screening. So let's start with the first one. Of course the two axes are interact. So we know the two axes, and we know that T3 and T4, thyroxine, the major production of the thyroid gland, has receptors to the ovary. On the other hand, production of the ovary, specifically estrogen and progesterone, have an act on the upper level hypothalamus and pituitary of the thyroid axis. So there is evidence that the two axes are interplay. And this is clinically evident, actually. If I go from a chronological age, from puberty up to menopause, you can see that a lot of disturbance of the genetic axis, like precocious puberty or delayed puberty, has been associated with thyroid disease. So once again, the evidence is there. When we discuss about thyroid pathology, we mainly discuss about three things. One is hyperthyroid, that is, by definition, increased T3 and T4 with decreased TSH. If only TSH is decreased, this is once again, by definition, subclinical hyperthyroidism. We have the opposite, hypothyroid, increased TSH, decreased FT4 and FT3. Once again, if only TSH is elevated, we have subclinical hypothyroidism. And we have thyroid autoimmunity, cases that the thyroid function may be absolutely normal, but you have increased levels of anti-thyroglobulin or anti-TPO antibodies. In the latest 10 years, actually, we measure a third type of antibodies, antibodies specifically against TSH receptor. So, of course, there is evidence to us again that in cases of thyrotoxicosis and hypothyroidism, almost every single hormone of the reproductive axis, of genetic axis, is altered. It goes either up or down according to the case in both males and females. But what about autoimmunity only? Once again, cases that the antibodies are high. Does this an impact to the reproductive failures? There are three main theories. One saying that if I have antibodies, these are bad news for my thyroid, so I'm going to develop subclinical hypothyroidism. There is another theory that if I have thyroid autoimmunity, I'm going to have another generalized form of autoimmunity. And there is another theory saying that thyroid autoimmunity has a direct effect on reproductive tissues. Well, let's see the evidence about this. You can see here that if we take women like the ones we are discussing today, with and with recurrent spontaneous abortion or unexplained infertility, and you divide it according to the thyroid autoimmunity status, so antibody positive and antibody negative. The ones with positive autoimmunity, they have higher population of natural killer cells, and this is, as you know, not good news for implantation. On the other hand, the famous balance between TH1 and TH2 autoimmunity is disturbed if you have thyroid autoimmunity. So there might be a connection here through thyroid autoantibodies only. If you want another evidence, here it is. Once again, if you take the same women with repeated implantation failures and I divide them according to the presence of or not of thyroid autoantibodies, you can see that the women with positive thyroid autoimmunity, they have other non-specific antibodies as well. Not the classical antibodies for the antiphospholipid syndrome, but not specific one, a double-strand DNA, single-strand DNA, so on. So that's another implication of their involvement. And of course, thyroid antibodies are present in the follicular fluid. You do not expect to find antibodies if your woman is negative in the serum, but if she is positive, she has antibodies, then you would expect something like half of the titer of the concentration in the follicular fluid as compared to the peripheral blood. Well, in Thessaloniki, we tried to see what's happening with TSH antibodies, antibodies once again specifically against TSH receptor, and we formulated what we used to call the corpus luteum hypothesis. TSH, of course, acts through its receptor, as does the HCG through its HCGLH receptor. And we know, because of structural similarities, that there is a certain cross-reaction between these two axes. So imagine that a woman has negative antibodies, inhibitory antibodies for TSH receptor. She is going to develop hypothyroidism. On the other hand, because of this certain cross-reactivity, she may develop a progesterone insufficiency, actually, so secretory phase insufficiency, and this may be another implication for interaction. In order to make a little simple, it seems that if we think of the interaction between thyroid and reproduction, we may think of two main themes. One has to do with autoimmunity per se, so concurrent autoimmunity has to do with interferons and NK cells and all the things we have discussed, and the other has to do with the hormones TSH, T3, T4, and this involves mainly an ovarian as compared to a hostile uterus, a uterine environment. So two ways of interaction. Can we transfer this into the clinical evidence? Once again, there is no doubt that if you have clinical thyrotoxicosis, hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism, you have to treat it, no doubt about this. Even you have to treat even subclinical hypothyroidism, because there is good evidence, and you can see here the evidence, that the possibility of a spontaneous miscarriage increased by a relative risk of about 2. You may have other things with hypothyroidism. The most famous one is the fetal intellectual one. We do not afraid about congenital anomalies in case of subclinical hypothyroidism. What we are afraid actually is spontaneous miscarriages. Now, an interesting thing is that if you take specific group of women, women with specific causes of infertility, for example, endometriosis, you are going to find that these women have a relative risk of 2 of having thyroid autoimmunity as well. We consider endometriosis as an immunological disease, so you may expect that these two diseases may coexist, thyroid autoimmunity and endometriosis, because endometriosis has to do with endometrial antigen as well, complement deposits, and so on. On the other hand, what you would not expect probably to find is thyroid, an association between thyroid autoantibodies and PCOS. But the evidence is still here. You can say if you take a group of women that the cause of infertility is PCOS, they have a relative risk of 3 of having thyroid autoimmunity as well. And of course, we are not very sure how this interaction takes place. I gave you already some evidence about the interaction of estradiol and PT4 and progesterone, which is evidence actually an increased ratio in PCOS in the interaction of the upper levels of the thyroid disease, but still more work have to be done here. The evidence is there. So in this slide that I show you, the connection of thyroid and reproduction through autoimmunity and through actually actual hormonal levels, you have to add endometriosis on the immunological part, and you have to add concurrent PCOS in the hormonal part of it. Now, once again, if you have thyroid autoimmunity only, you have a possibility, the same with subclinical hypothyroidism, you have a possibility of miscarriage, a relative risk of about 2. And there is good evidence about this. In Thessaloniki, we try to see what is specifically happening in women entering an IVF cycle. So risk of spontaneous miscarriages in euthyroid women with thyroid autoimmunity undergoing IVF. And we found exactly the same number, relative risk of 2. So the possibility for an early miscarriage, if you have only antibodies, is increased by a factor of 2. And we have only one paper saying that if you treat this condition, if you give 50 micrograms of thyroxine, once again, the lady is perfectly euthyroid, she has only thyroid antibodies, then you can reduce this high possibility. I mean, the possibility of having an abortion is reduced to the basic level. If I want to put it all this together, you can see that if you find women with unexplained subfertility here, they have 1.47, so an increase of about 50% probability of having thyroid autoimmunity. This does not imply, of course, that thyroid autoimmunity is the cause of the unexplained, in inverted commas, possibility, but we have to consider this. Now, what's happening exactly in women entering assisting reproduction technique cycle? You would expect an involvement of the thyroid gland because you have a high increase in estradiol levels that will goes up the TBG, so less free thyroxine is available. You can add thyroid autoimmunity. You can add iodine deficiency, actually raw material for the production of thyroid hormones, which is quite prevalent even in the Europe. So you would expect a problem there. You would expect a degree of subclinical hypothyroidism, increased TSH and decreased free T4. And indeed, this evidence is there. This is one of our systematic analysis, systematic reviews, trying to see what's happening there. These are the studies. So you can see that for women entering an IVF or an ICSI cycle, if they start the cycle with a TSH of 2.3, at the end of the ovarian stimulation, this goes up to 3. TSH goes up to 3, which is quite important. I have to remind you that according to the latest guidelines, the optimal level of TSH in order to start the pregnancy, so during early pregnancy, is 2.5. So you can see that only with ovarian stimulation, this level, let's say, this threshold has been cut, has been surpassed. The same is true for women with or without thyroid autoimmunity. It seems that it doesn't take any matter. Once again, TSH goes up even further in the study, almost doubled. From an initial level of 1.8, it went up to 3.3. And this is a study that we are never going to do again. This is subclinical hypothyroidism that the authors did not treat. So they start from the initial level of 6.6, so a little elevated, subclinical hypothyroidism. And they didn't treat, so it remained at the end of ovarian stimulation 6.8. And in this case, they treat, so TSH went down from 6.6 to 2.9. And of course, as you would expect, this is not thyroid autoimmunity, this is true subclinical hypothyroidism. There was significant differences in live birth rate and in the miscarriage rate. So we always treat subclinical hypothyroidism. Now in Thessaloniki, we try our best to do, I mean for scientific purposes, detailed analysis of the axis. So we have TSH for day 3, day 5, HCG, OPU, pregnancy test, so many estimations of the thyroid axis, and you can see the clear increase in TSH, the clear stress of the axis during an ART cycle. Now, in order to finish this part of the talk, let's see what we can do about treatment, actually. All the societies, and the American Thyroid Society, the American Endocrine Society, and the European Thyroid Society, they do agree that if you have subclinical hypothyroidism, especially if you have thyroid autoimmunity as well, you have to treat. There is no doubt about this. The majority of the societies agree that if you have only subclinical hypothyroidism, you have to treat as well. What is quite strange is that there is no universal agreement about screening of this case. And probably in your practices, you may not screen necessarily all women for thyroid disease. Well, we try our best to convince that the opposite is true. For me, screening for thyroid disease is an ideal way of screening. I mean, diseases are quite prevalent. The possibility of a young woman to have thyroid autoimmunity is something like 15% in the general population, so quite prevalent. The screening tests are there. You just measure TSH and the antibodies. It's of low cost, without risk. And you have a therapy. You may not have the best evidence in the world that we have a beneficial effect, but of course we do not harm at any case in this case. That's why we are big fans of universal screening. These are some of our letters. So in order to make it even more practical, this is a usual screening for a thyroid disease. If you have thyroid disease, for no reproductive purposes, and you visit your endocrinologist. What we can do for reproduction purposes is to measure TSH, so very simply to see if we have a case of subclinical hypo or hyperthyroidism, and then to check for the usual antibodies, because thyroid autoimmunity by itself have some problems. And then we have to treat with levothyroxine. There is no evidence about other ways to fight autoimmunity, like glucocorticoids or selenium. So if you want to treat, you are going to give thyroxine only. And I would accept this study published by a Belgian group, saying that if you universal screen your women at the beginning of the reproductive cycle with TSH and antibodies, and TSH is increased more than 2.5, then you have to start T4 therapy before starting the ovarian stimulation. Anyway, we all agree that you have to start 30 days later if your woman becomes pregnant. So why not to start treating 30 days earlier, having in mind that your intervention, the ovarian stimulation, may even increase further TSH. If TSH is low, then you have to consider your endocrinologist about a case of hyperthyroidism. If TSH is perfectly normal and you have no antibodies, then you just follow up. But if you have antibodies only, you have to treat as well. Now, the final conclusion for this part of the talk. Thyroid hormones play an important role in reproductive function. Thyroid dysfunction, including thyroid autoimmunity, can lead to menstrual irregularities and subfertility. Women with subfertility should be screened universally, I would say, for thyroid dysfunction, especially if they have endometriosis or PCOS. And when dysfunction is detected, you have to treat with LT4. Now I'm going briefly go to the second small part of my talk that has to do with an emerging thing, hypovitaminosis D. This is the well-known vitamin D. We have two forms of it, D2 and D3. You mainly get D3 through the sun in order to have your D2. This is mainly by fish and yellow cheese. Vitamin D is an inactive vitamin. It's actually a hormone, a true hormone, and not a vitamin. In order to be active, it has to undergo a double hydroxylation in the liver and in the kidney, so a 1 and 25 hydroxylation, in order to have the active form, which is the 125 vitamin D. Once again, this is a slide to make you believe that this is a true hormone. It has a receptor. It's not a coactivator or an enzyme like the other vitamins. So it's a true hormone acting through vitamin D receptor. It has a genomic action. It actually has a non-genomic action through a cytoplasmic receptor. And it has been evolved with almost everything. If you have groups of patients with osteoporosis, inflammation, atherosclerosis, whatever you want, vitamin D levels, they are going to be lower as compared to controls without the disease. So what I would like to do is, if there are to discuss if there are components of vitamin D system present in the reproductive system, and the answer is for sure yes. A reproductive system of women is full of vitamin D system. You have vitamin D receptor in the endometrium, imagine the consequences, in the fallopian tubes, and you have the enzymes there in order to produce the active form. The same is true for the follicle. So vitamin D receptor in the granulosa cells and the oocyte itself, vitamin D receptor in the placenta, in the decidual, whatever, wherever you run. So it's always there. Do we have evidence of a physiological role of vitamin D in reproduction? We try to summarize this evidence in one of our review articles, and to make a long story short, you can see that there is some evidence, not the best in the world, that vitamin D has been involved in the stimulation of ovarian steroidogenesis and even the regulation of the famous antimullerian hormone. Another very important thing is that if you have vitamin D deficiency, you have 3 times 2.5 more possibilities of having thyroid autoimmunity as well. And you may expect this because vitamin D is an actual immunomoderator. So the two immunological statuses coexist. Now, what about clinical data? I want to talk a little about endometriosis, once again, known connections with inflammation and autoimmunity. And there is some evidence, not the best in the world, and I have to say that this is data from observational studies, not from interventional, not from studies that they actually gave vitamin D as a drug, as manager. So in endometriosis, you can see that vitamin D binding protein is lower in these women. There is a general dysregulation of vitamin D system in women with endometriosis. What about polycystic ovaries? The same picture, more or less. Once again, if you have polycystic ovaries, you have a negative correlation with bad things, as it is increased BMI and increased fasting glucose, and you have a positive correlation with good things, as it is insulin sensitivity and having high concentration of HDL cholesterol. Even in assisted reproduction techniques, there is evidence that if you have high follicular fluid of 25 hydroxylate vitamin D, you have higher possibilities of clinical pregnancy. Once again, I want to be careful, this is just observational and not interventional data. So what about, and I'm going to finish with this, what about supplements? We all agree now that sufficient level is more than 30 nanograms per ml, deficiency less than 20, and we have the intermediate insufficiency level between 20 and 30 nanograms per ml. So our target is to have to establish level at the sufficient point, more than 30 micrograms per ml. It's not easy to find a vitamin D. You can find in salmon, actually, quite high amount, but otherwise there is not enough in everyday food, so you have to fortify cereal and milk with vitamin D. The problem is that even in the sunny Greece, we have huge amount of women with vitamin D deficiency in pregnancy. Something like 50, 60, even 70% of the population, even in Mediterranean countries, have low vitamin D. You can see evidence from the Mediterranean countries, 50%, 60% vitamin D deficiency and insufficiency. And of course, we are afraid about this. I'm going to skip this. We are afraid about possible consequences for the for the mother, preeclampsia, gestational diabetes, all these have been involved with lower levels of vitamin D. And more or less for the fetal origin of adult disease, I mean long-term consequences in the fetus, like bone development, what's happening with the bones of this of this offspring. So the recommendation is to supply vitamin D to all pregnant and lactating women, and I would go, and this is the recommended daily allowance by Institute of Medicine, I would go to something like 2,000 to 3,000 international units per day. It seems that 600 is too low in order to establish the concentrations we have discussed. So, concerning vitamin D, we saw that vitamin D system is present in virtually all female reproductive tissue. It is involved in a spectrum of intracellular mechanisms. Its deficiency have been associated with endometriosis, PCOS, and IVF outcome, and pregnant women have to be supplemented with vitamin D in order to prevent this effect. The modern trend is that vitamin D has been transformed from a calcium vitamin, let's say, to a true hormone that has ovarian, endometrium, and placenta aspect as well. Well, thank you very much for your kind attendance. So there is something that your endocrinologist can do for you, am I right?
Thank you, we appreciate it. Okay, we have time for a couple of short questions. Who would start? Back there, thank you.
Yes, please, Han, Germany. Could you please give us your comment on the treatment of the clinical situation where you have very high, excessive levels of antibodies, thyroid antibodies? What is your advice, or what is your treatment recommendation?
Treatment of what?
High thyroid antibodies.
High thyroid antibodies.
What is your treatment recommendation?
Yeah. Once again, we have only one randomized trial. So once again, TSH is absolutely normal. Thyroid function is absolutely normal. But you have high titers of either anti-TPO or anti-DG antibodies. I have only one randomized trial, but I have one. In other cases, we have none, actually, that if we give 50 micrograms of thyroxine, then you can prevent this excessive percentage of miscarriages, first trimester miscarriages. And once again, I will try my TSH level to be between 2.0 and 2.5. There is no evidence that you have to continue this after the first trimester, unless TSH is more than 3, let's say.
Okay, the next one. Thank you for your interesting talk. My name is Kate McElwain from Australia. My question really follows on from that. For women with subclinical hypothyroidism, as
subclinical
well as
hypothyroidism,
as well as the TPO antibodies that we've started on 50 micrograms of thyroxine,
yeah.
In both of these groups of women, what's the recommendations for both duration of treatment and also for monitoring during pregnancy?
Yeah. So I want to start with, I mean, my higher levels is TSH 2.5 for the first trimester and 3 for the second and third trimester. So if my women start pregnancy with higher level, let's say 3 or 4, then I would give 50 micrograms of thyroxine. If it has to do with antibodies only, I may give more if her TSH is higher than this. And I'm going to measure it quite often, I mean, in a month's time, in order to be sure that I have decreased TSH to the level I want. After I have established an equilibrium there and TSH is normal, then I'm going to see it once every trimester. So once in the second trimester and once in the third trimester, in order to be sure that TSH remains under 3.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, we have time, yes, back there.
Ricardo Rueda, Colombia. Thank you so much for this excellent executive summary of evidence on vitamin D deficiency and the volume in reproduction. One of the main problems we face is the technique with which we measure vitamin D. There are several assays out there, but it seems like HPLC, high performance liquid chromatography, is perhaps the most reliable one. Is that your recommendation, given the fact that this technique is not widely available?
Yeah, you are very true, actually, and this is a main problem. Actually, we have something like 10 forms of vitamin D. And not only this, we have epimers. I mean, these are vitamin D forms that they are, you can measure it. It is in the overall thing that you, the total vitamin D that you measure, but they are biologically inactive. So something like 24% is epimer, which is actually inactive. So the problem is even high. So if we want to measure, to make it practical actually now, I would go for measuring only to a total 25 hydroxylated vitamin D. So the sum of 25 hydroxylated D2 plus D3, that gives you an impression of what's happening in terms of vitamin D restores there for the last month actually. So levels of 25 hydroxylated D reflect the last month. Now, concerning the method, I would agree with you that HPLC is the most reliable way to measure vitamin D, and in different forms, but unfortunately, it's not widely available.
Okay, that's it. I think we are doing our time, so I'm sorry, we are out of time, so maybe you can reach him after the session. Thank you. Okay, well, thank you so much, Dr. Goulis.